Take your songbooks, turn to 226. 226.
To arrive at home, Jesus taught me.
Take your copy of God's Word, turn to Isaiah, the 29th chapter. We're going to look at a little bit tonight in case you see flickering. We're getting some good rain again and a little bit of lightning that goes with it. But the electricity and the service is a lot better than it used to be. We used to have a 10-mile-an-hour wind that would knock our electricity out because of a transmission line all the way to Mule Creek. I'm thankful to Don Perry and some others that fixed that years ago. And he's one of the deacons over at Silver. So I want to ask you a question. I usually don't do this, but because it kind of gets you in a trap. But do you know any secrets that nobody else knows? Jimmy Kimmel is a entertainment host at ABC. He does After the News usually. And he asked President Clinton, and he asked President Bush, the younger Bush, and he asked President Obama. He said to Obama, he says, "I just know what I would do if I were president. As soon as my hand was hot off the Bible," and he didn't catch people laughing in the audience why his hand would be hot, but okay. He said, the first thing I would want to do is I'd want to go see about Area 51 and the secrets about aliens." Clinton said there wasn't anything to it. Bush says, "I can't tell you that." Obama says, "That's why you'll never be president." You can go today to where Area 51 is, and nobody will say a word to you. Nobody will talk to you. Nobody will do anything to you at all. But about 15 years ago, NBC News, Lester Holt, did an experiment. They did it with the government's permission, but they were supposed to play along. And so he hired this private pilot. Private pilot took him within 3 miles of Area 51, and all of a sudden you hear this announcement. You're entering restricted airspace. Turn your aircraft to the north or to the south. They got within 2 miles. This is your last warning. You are entering restricted airspace. You need to turn left or turn right or turn back the way you came. And they got within 1 mile and they said, this is it. If you do not turn around within 30 seconds, we are shooting you down. Of course, the pilot and Lester Holt made a U-turn very quickly with the government knowing what was going on. But there are secrets in Area 51 that have nothing to do with aliens. They have to do with top secret military aircraft. For example, in 1991, in the Gulf War, we learned about a plane called the F-117 stealth bomber. The F-117 was designed to absorb radar. The way radar works is it shoots out a signal and it comes back. And a lot of the advances have been made for weather especially, but nobody had ever seen that technology before 1991. Do you know when it was invented? Do you know when they started working on it? 1974 at Area 51. I have been told by people who got a very close glimpse of it, but got enough of a glimpse, that there is a plane that is being developed at Area 51 that is twice the size of Colgate High School. That's a big plane. That's a huge plane. That's the biggest, that's bigger than the biggest plane we've got in the world, which has, if I remember right, I just saw a YouTube video not long ago, it's about 10 wheels, 5 wheels on each side to observe it. Can you believe God's people thought they could hide something from God? Can you imagine that God's people, who had the heritage of Mount Sinai and the awful sight that it caused and created, but decided that they were going to hide, to keep secret from God, political alliances. Now, I've told you this before, and I'll tell you again, if Hebrews 4:13 is right, there is nothing we can hide from God. When people would get excited years ago about President Obama and his pro-Muslim agenda, which he was doing, he was trying to get rid of Christianity in so many places and put Muslims in and put pro-Muslim stuff. I kept telling people, you forget who's watching all of this. You forget the all-seeing eye is watching you. And incidentally, those who were members of the church who advocated his assassination for it, God was watching them as well. And we need to be very careful about what we think we can hide from God. Because number one, nobody can hide from God. Nobody can hide from God. Look at what they're trying to do. God's people were trying, now this is when the 10 northern tribes were separated from the 2 southern tribes, but God's people tried to hide from God the political alliances they had made with Egypt. Now, later on, Jeremiah is going to tell Israel, going to tell Judah, excuse me, the 2 southern tribes, you think that you can do the same thing your brothers did in the north. They went down to defeat Assyria because Egypt could not save them. The reason? The things being done were being done by God. When you read Ezekiel and you read that he is required on chapter 3 to lay 390 days for the sins of Israel, and he's to eat The same food every day. Boy, I could just hear it now, couldn't you? Aren't you ever going to stop making spaghetti? Aren't you ever tired of eating hamburgers, Dad? Aren't you ever tired? I mean, he ate the same bread, the same food. God provided it for him. Then when he was through with that, he's to turn over on his right side and lay 40 days for each year of disobedience of Judah. That's 430 years that God was merciful to his people. And when I hear people say God wasn't merciful in the Old Testament, but he sure is now, I go, you don't know the scriptures, do you? Because if God had behaved the way we do, oh, he'd have wiped, we'd have been never here. We'd have been wiped off the face of the map. God told him not to do it. I liked what Katani, the winner of the Toastmasters 2015 International, he said he walked in to his son, and his son was about 2 years old, 3 years old, and he's drawing on the wall. He's just drawing all over with a crayon. And he said, "Don't be stupid. Don't draw on the wall." And he said he walked out of the room. His son was mad. His son was sulking. His son started crying. He walked out of the room, and he said a week later, he goes to his room. Guess what he's doing again? He's writing on the wall. And he said, but this time, I turned to my son, and I said, I got right down near him, and said, "Son, you're a bigger boy than that. Big boys don't write on walls. Big boys write on paper." And he said, it was a shock. He not only got his son to help him clean the wall, but his son never wrote on it again. Good to see, he said, my mistake was calling my son stupid. Telling my son that he's stupid for what he's doing instead of getting down there and sympathizing with him a little bit and telling him and teaching him otherwise. God told him not to do it. Now, somebody says, well, I know God told him not to do it, but you know, you just said God's merciful. And so God just tolerated it, right? Well, to a point. You read the rest of Isaiah, you read Jeremiah, and you read Ezekiel, and you'll find out, especially in Isaiah and Jeremiah, just how tolerant God was. In fact, Jeremiah wrote 5 chapters about the city of Jerusalem alone. How lonely sits the city that was once full of people. But you see, they refused to listen to God. They already had mixed their pagan religion with what God wanted, and God told them not to do that either, but they go ahead and do it anyway. And so what does God do? Go back to the book of Habakkuk in chapter 1. When Habakkuk is just asking God, can you just change the people a little bit? Can you just we call it in 2020, can you reprogram their brains? And God says, I'm going to do a work in your days that even if you were told, you would not believe it. I'm going to send the most evil empire in the world to conquer my people. They're going to invade from the north. And Habakkuk's like, I didn't want to hear that. How do I know that? Because when he makes the request, what are you going to do about evil in the world? Habakkuk says in chapter 2, verse 2, I'm just going to sit here till he reproves me. Not if he reproves me, till he reproves me. And so God poured his wrath on them. Because here's what they were doing. Who sees us? Who knows what's going on? I have friends. I have colleagues. I have people that are doing things that I know about that I couldn't prove. Except I've had a lot of people tell me. I've had a lot of kids tell me. And the crazy thing is, what Solomon said in Ecclesiastes is still true today. What has been, will be. What will be, has already been. It's just repeating itself over and over again. We just see it a little more today. Because we have so many advances in technology. We have so many advances in this, and this. That we forget sometimes that God sees everything. When somebody will ask me years ago, why won't I take my revenge on somebody? And I point to them Romans chapter 12 and Hebrews chapter 10. Vengeance is whose? Mine, God says. I will repay, says the Lord. Besides all that, I can't get even. One guy even said, you know what? I just punch his lights out. I said, you know what would happen? I'd go to jail for battery, and then on top of that, my wrist and my fist would hurt so badly for a long time. And I said, he'd get the best of me then. So why would I want to do that? But there are people who think God's not watching. God's not watching. They're almost as silly as the burglar I heard about. You probably heard it, but bear with me. About the burglar who broke into a house and he's starting to rummage through the expensive dishes and the jewelry. And all of a sudden he hears this, Jesus is watching you. Well, he looks all around with his flashlight and he can't see anything. And so he goes back to rummaging through and is trying to steal this and this and this. And he hears it again, Jesus is watching you. And he looks and there's a parrot inside this birdcage. And he says, were you the one making that noise? And the parrot goes, yes. He said, well, pretty bird, what's your name? He said, Moses. And the burglar stood there a minute and he said, who are the idiots that would name their parrot, their bird, Moses? And the parrot said, the same people that would name their Rottweiler Jesus. Sick 'em, Jesus. Nobody's watching. Nobody's seeing. And you know very good and well who is watching. In fact, they act like what Jeremiah talked in Jeremiah 18. This is what would allude to here in Isaiah. You see, they had things turned around. They said to the potter, who fashioned us? They said the clay was talking to, you can't do anything to us. We are the ones are in charge. And God says, excuse me, I'm the potter. You're the clay. I made you. You didn't make me. And this is what happens in a lot of worship today. I've been noticing a movement in the religious world, and I mean completely in the religious world. There was a guy that decided to illustrate how Jesus is going to return. And he got in the second story of the auditorium and he started sitting on a swing. And he was belted for safety reasons as well. And as he came down, he started quoting from Revelation chapter 1 and verse 7. And I was surprised that the guy that they were interviewing about it said, I don't think that's the way Jesus is going to return. I don't think that's what Jesus is going to do, be sitting on a swing. In fact, he misquoted Revelation 7, the guy. He says, the sky is going to crack. No, he's going to come in the clouds. Jesus doesn't need a crack in the world to come. He already had descended once. He's ascended now. He's coming back not to set foot on earth. But this ungodly way of saying, now, here's what I'm going to tell you, God. I don't like worship. Or I don't like the way, the old way to worship. I don't like reading Bible. I don't like singing. I don't like partaking in crackers and eating grape juice or drinking grape juice. And I don't like giving my money. And God, you're going to take it and you're going to shove it down your throat. And God's like, uh-uh. No way. You see, they tried to hide the real interior with a fake exterior. Does this ring any bells to anybody? Jesus said in Matthew 23, when he blistered the Pharisees and the Sadducees, but especially the Pharisees, my goodness, he said things like, you're whitewashed tombs. You look good on the outside, but on the inside, you're full of dead men's bones. One day I saw a coffee cup, and it was morning, and so I went to get the coffee cup. And this is what I had before I had the Keurig. And I went to go pour it, and I looked inside that coffee cup, and I went, ooh. You see, it was okay looking from the outside, but you didn't dare want to drink coffee. And look, I'm one of these old timers that I don't really believe in washing a coffee cup. I mean, it ruins the taste of the coffee. That's kind of my attitude sometimes. Now, I will do it, but I wouldn't drink that. I wouldn't even mess with that. And Jesus said, you can't be that way and be pleasing to God. That's what they were doing here. Because you see, God sees everything. And he will not excuse anyone who rebels. Now, I know what's popular. And I know we don't like hearing about woes. In fact, one preacher said not long ago, and it kind of disturbed me what he said. He says, you know, I used to be a Christian because of what I was afraid was going to happen to me. Now I'm a Christian because I know I'm going to appreciate what will happen to me. And I get what he's saying. You know, we've been forgiven, we've been redeemed, we've been adopted, you know, as children of God. But sometimes we just get so out of sorts about destruction and punishment and hell that we don't even want to talk about it. We're like that young man who walked up to Jonathan Edwards in 1764. And I'm sad that Jonathan Edwards was not a member of the Lord's church. He was an Anglican preacher. But he preached a sermon called Sinners in the Hands of an Angry God. And he used Hebrews 10, 30, and 31 as a scripture text. And he turned around and he got through, and one young man walked up to him and said, Mr. Edwards, that was a mighty fine sermon, but don't you realize nobody preaches on hell anymore? And Mr. Edwards looked at him and says, does that mean hell went away? Does that mean hell is gone? Of course not. Jesus said, Matthew 25, 46, describing those who didn't care, describing those who weren't concerned, describing those who had the opportunity but didn't do anything about it, these will go into everlasting punishment, but the righteous into eternal life. When Jesus gave us three of the five senses, you think about hell and there's nobody that wants to go. First of all, you can't see anything. It's pitch black. Second of all you hear is gritting and screaming, gritting of teeth and screaming. Because of the third sense, that is the torments that people will be in. And that's going to be for eternity. That's not going to be annihilation as some people live in a dream world about. It's going to be forever. My dad said when he was alive, he said, Dwayne, you bring them to Duke, Oklahoma. And he used to work at a wallboard plant. And he stood between 200-300 degree kilns. Now, he said, it was nice in the winter. He said, man, that winter would get cold. Man, he said, all you had to do is stand between those kilns. Man, it's nice. But he said, what was brutal was summer. He said, it get to 102, 105 degrees outside. It was 110 and 120 inside. He said, you tell them when they want to go to hell, bring them to Duke. I will take them between those two kilns. That doesn't even come close to what hell's going to be. See, God's true people are going to enjoy life. You see, God demonstrates a role reversal here. Look at verse 17. Is it not yet a very little while till Lebanon shall be turned into a fruitful field? You see, he addressed in the first part of chapter 29, Jerusalem being that fruitful field. He called it Ariel. But look what happens. Now you got a role reversal. Lebanon was supposed to be the desolate. Now it's going to be the fruitful. And the fruitful field be esteemed as a forest. In that day the deaf will hear the words of the book, and the eyes of the blind will see out of obscurity and out of darkness. The humble will also increase their joy in the Lord, and the poor among men shall rejoice in the Holy One of Israel. For the terrible one is brought to nothing. The scornful one is consumed, and all who watch for iniquity are cut off. who make a man an offender of by a word, and lay a snare for him who improves him in the gate, and turn aside the just by empty words. Therefore, thus says the Lord, who redeemed Abraham concerning the house of Jacob, Jacob will not now be ashamed, nor shall his face grow pale. But when he sees his children, the work of my hands in his midst, they will hallow my name and hallow the Holy One of Jacob and fear the Lord God of Israel. These also who erred in spirit will come to understanding, and those who complained will learn doctrine. You see, Israel now becomes a barren place. Because what God is going to do is he's going to end the nation of Israel, the 10 northern tribes. He's going to have the nation of Judah for another 40 years after that. Because you see, the spiritual blindness. Go back up to chapter 29, verse 15. Remember what he talked about, the blindness? I'm sorry, 29, I'm in the wrong chapter. No wonder, I apologize. Go back to verse 15. Woe to those who seek counsel, or deep to hide their counsel far from the Lord, and their works are in the dark. They say, who sees and who knows? Surely you have things turned around. Shall the potter be esteemed as the clay? For shall the thing made say of him who made it, he did not make me? Or shall the thing formed say of him who formed it, he has no understanding? But go back up to verse number 9. Pause and wonder. Blind yourselves and be blind. They are drunk, but not with wine. They stagger, but not with intoxicating drink. For the Lord has poured out on you the spirit of deep sleep, and has closed your eyes, namely the prophets. And he's covered your heads, namely the seers. And if you look what Jesus said in Matthew 15, 8, 9, these people worship me with their words, but their heart is far from me, for in vain they worship me, teaching as doctrine the commandments of men. They mixed pagan with what God wanted. Matthew 11, 5 says Jesus cured people of their blindness. He not only cured it of their physical blindness, but their spiritual blindness. Now you want to talk about a group of people who are blind, it's the Pharisees and the Sadducees. Waited thousands of years for the Messiah. Waited hundreds of years for the Messiah. And when he's there, they can't even recognize him. Because you see, he didn't come in this glorified state. He didn't come in this idea of a government like they thought. You see, he just came and was a servant. The humble one will increase their joy. The poor will rejoice in the Holy One of Israel. The first two Beatitudes say, blessed are the poor in spirit. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Now, what does that mean? You see, I grew up being told that meant you had to be poor all your life. You weren't entitled to any money because Christian people weren't supposed to have money. Because Jesus said in Matthew 5, blessed are the poor. That isn't what he said. Blessed are the poor in spirit. They are the Corneliuses of Acts chapter 10 when God said, send to Simon the tanner. Send for Simon Peter. Your prayers and your alms have come up as a memorial before God, but you're not right with me. And he will tell you what you need to do. It comes in the form of Acts 22, 16. When Ananias told Paul, why do you wait? Why do you tarry? Arise and be baptized and wash away your sins, calling on the name of the Lord. It comes in the form of Philippians 4, 4, when Jesus said, or Paul said, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I'll say rejoice. Now, it's easy for me to say, but the last day or two has been hard for me to rejoice. There's some circumstances, situation that just go on in my mind and I let it get the best of me sometimes. I shouldn't do that. Because what better place do I have? What better standing do I have than that of the Lord? Now, here's what really You know, you can understand the people doing this maybe, but you see, the leaders were doing it. They're as bad as Saul back in 1 Samuel 17. Saul's taller than anybody else. There's that 9-foot-9 tall Goliath who comes out for 40 days and taunts and derides and disrespects and tells the armies of the living God, you know what, send me somebody out here to fight. The one that should have been out there fighting was Saul, but what's he doing? He's hiding. He's hiding. And so God tells the leaders to stop using their power for personal gain. I was talking with someone the other day, and he said that a congressman told him that it is scary how much money we are being paid. I'm going to let you salivate on that for about 5 seconds. It is scary how much we're getting, how much money there is that we get. Because, you see, we make the decisions, and God says, you better watch it. You're being called into account because there's an all-seeing eye that watches you. Go to Ezekiel chapter 8. It's one of my favorite passages because it keeps me humble. And when about the time I think I have everything figured out, I find out I didn't have anything figured out. And this reminds me of what's going on. It came to pass in the sixth year, in the sixth month, on the fifth day of the month, as I sat in my house with the elders of Judah sitting before me, that the hand of the Lord God fell upon me there. And I looked, and there was a likeness, like the appearance of fire, from the appearance of his waist and downward fire, and from his waist and upward, like the appearance of brightness, like the color of amber. He stretched out the form of a hand and took me by a lock of my hair, and the Spirit lifted me between heaven between the ground and heaven, and brought me in visions of God to Jerusalem, to the door of the north gate of the inner court, where the seat was the image of jealousy was, which provokes to jealousy. And behold, the glory of the Lord God of Israel was there, like the vision I saw in the plain. And he said to me, Son of man, lift your eyes now toward the north. So I lifted my eyes toward the north, and there, north of the altar, was the image of jealousy in the entrance. Furthermore, he said to me, Son of man, do you see what they're doing, the great abominations that the house of Israel commits here to make me go far away from my sanctuary? Now turn again, you'll see greater abominations. So he brought me to the door of the court, and when I looked, there was a hole in the wall. And he said to me, Son, dig into the wall. And when I dug into the wall, there was a door. And he said to me, Go in and see the wicked abominations, which they are doing. So I went in and saw, and there every sort of creeping thing, abominable beast, and all the house of Israel portrayed all around the walls. And there stood before them 70 men of the elders of Israel, and in their midst stood Janazah, the son of Shaphan, and each man had a censer in his hand, and a thick cloud of incense went up, and he said to me, Son of man, have you seen what the elders of the house of Israel do in the dark, every man in the room of his idols? For they say, The Lord does not see us. Does that sound familiar? The Lord has forsaken the land. And he said to me, Turn again, and you'll see greater abominations that they are doing. So he brought me to the door of the north gate of the Lord's house. And to my dismay, women were sitting there weeping for Tammuz. That's a pagan god. Then he said to me, Have you seen this, O son of man? Turn again, you'll see greater abominations than these. So he brought me into the inner court of the Lord's house there at the door of the temple of the Lord between the porch and the altar were about 25 men with their backs toward the temple of the Lord and their faces toward the east, and they were worshiping the sun toward the east. And he said to me, Have you seen this, O man? Is it a trivial thing to the house of Judah to commit the abominations which they commit here? For they have filled the land with violence. Then they have returned to provoke me to anger. Indeed, they put the branch to their nose, and therefore I will act in my fury. My eye will not spare, nor will I have pity. Though they cry in my ears with a loud voice, I will not hear them. You go to chapter 25, and God tells Ezekiel, I am going to take your wife. You can sigh for her. You can groan for her. But you cannot cry for her. Oh my goodness. God, why would you do that? From every indication in the text, she seems to be a godly wife. And God says, what I want you to understand is that you are me, and Judah and Israel are your wife. And I have had all I can take. My limit of mercy is right here, and it's slowly dwindling. And so what does God do? God comes up with a plan. God comes up with a plan as the late Stafford North, he died today, says, I found a way that I can take the sins of the world and I can offer my son to be the atoning, the demand, the propitiation, the satisfaction of the hit God placed on each one of us to take care of the problem. You see, God will demonstrate grace. As we read, Jacob will not now be ashamed. By the way, he uses the word Jacob. Don't miss that. Jacob means deceiver. And Israel means God's people. Nor shall his face grow pale. When he sees his children, the work of my hands and his midst, they'll hollow my name and hollow the Holy One of Jacob and fear the God of Israel. And those who've erred will come to understanding, and those who murmured will learn doctrine. Oh, we don't want to hear doctrine today, Dwayne. We don't want to hear it. We've heard doctrine for so long, we don't want to hear it. Let me tell you something. Those people have forgotten what doctrine is. When I hear some of them say things to me, when I ask them, why aren't you coming back to church? And, well, church is just not that important. Where'd they get that? The scriptures say, do not forsake the assembling of yourselves, as some do. But exhort one another, so much as more as you see the day approaching. Where'd they get the concept that you only have to go one time? Or where do they get the concept of some of the things that they say? And I'm not trying to be arrogant when I say it. What I'm trying to say is, folks, they've lost doctrine. They've lost doctrine. But I want you to know, God is always willing to give mercy. 1 Timothy 2:3-4 says, God, it is the will of God that all people come to the knowledge of the truth. Peter said, 2 Peter 3:9, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering toward us, not willing that what? Any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. How's God going to take care of this? You see, he's going to bring back all of the tribes of Israel, the ones that split off in 1 Kings chapter 12, and he's going to put it into a unified nation, combining that with the Gentile nation. And it's called the church. The church which he bought. The church which he built. The church which he blessed. The church which will be with him for eternity. Romans 1:16-17 says, for I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it's the power of God unto salvation to everyone who believes, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek, for therein is the righteousness of God revealed from faith to faith, as it's written, the just shall live by faith. I want to correct something I said last Sunday night. I said 1 Corinthians 3:25 says the foolishness of this world is wiser than men. It's 1 Corinthians 1:25. And I had a friend of mine talking, we were talking a couple of weeks ago, and he said, you know, I was talking to a preacher. And he said, I never thought about it like this. He says, you just think about the story of the crucifixion. You think about the story of salvation. And he says, doesn't it sound absolutely crazy? Doesn't it sound so insane that one man died for the entire world? And I told him, Yeah, that's what Paul said in 1 Corinthians 1:18-21. To the Jews, the crucifixion, the story of salvation, is a stumbling block. And to the Greeks or the Gentiles, it's pure foolishness. But to us who are being saved, it is the power of God. That word power is the same word here in Romans 1. It comes from the Greek word dynamos. It is the dynamite to salvation. And how do we know we have that? Galatians 3:26-29. This should settle all racism questions. When Paul said, "For as many of you as were baptized into Christ have put on Christ, there's neither Jew nor Greek, there's neither slave nor free, there's neither male nor female, for you're all one in Christ Jesus. And if you are Christ, you're heirs according to the promise." Why? Because we are of Abraham's seed. You see, there is no division in Christ. There's no division in God. We may have different skin colors. We may come from different parts of the world. We may come from different parts of the country. But in Christ, we are one. And if we're not, then we've got a problem. The problem is that we've tried to hide from God. And the sad reality is those who hide from God do not realize that what they are going to do is stand before God on the day of judgment. And according to Ecclesiastes 12:14, and according to what Scripture teaches us, there's not one secret thing that we won't know. So if you have secrets, as I do, because people have confided in me, I haven't told them yet, and I'm not going to tell tomorrow. But if you try to hide from God, you're going to lose. You're going to lose. Now, that means I've got all my ducks in a row. That means I'm perfect, right? Far, far from it. I'm human just like everybody else. And it is so hard for me. I don't care how many times I quote it. I don't care how many times I say it. I don't care how many times I read it. It is so hard for me to understand 1 John 1:9. I know what it says. If we sin, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. You see, I'm used to the way the world works. You blow it once, you might get away with it. You blow it twice, you're treading on thin ice. And you know how some people think, the three-strike rule and you're out. God doesn't work that way. However, God doesn't even get to strike one if you don't do what He says to do. Don't hide from God. Hebrews 4:13 says, there is no creature hidden from His sight, but we're all going to give an account to God. You see, the man that we call Jesus, the one that we love, I know you see pictures of him with loincloths on, but I promise you, that didn't happen at the crucifixion. Go look up, see if I'm telling you the truth. He was absolutely stark naked. Now, why? Because if you'll recall back in the book of Genesis in chapter 3, Adam and Eve didn't realize they were what? Naked. When did they realize they were naked? When they sinned against God. Jesus took our sins upon Himself. The chastisement for us was laid on Him. And He willingly took it. And Hebrews 9:28 says He is appearing one more time for salvation. Why? Because it's appointed for men to die once. And after this comes the judgment. This evening, if you're here, we're going to sing a song of encouragement. The song of encouragement I didn't put it in the screen. I'm sorry. But it's designed to encourage. One of the things I liked about Revelation 4:4 and I put it in your notes, is the 24 elders. Why were there just 24? Why couldn't there have been 144? Why couldn't there have been 650? Why is that? Because you have the 12 tribes of Israel, the old covenant people of God, with the 12 apostles, the new covenant people of God. And what he wants is us to be in covenant relationship with him. And so, this evening, if you're here and we can serve you in some way, let us do it as we sing.
I heard an old, old story, how a Savior came from glory, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. I heard about his groaning, about his precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and bought me with his redeeming blood. He loved me ere I knew him, and all my love is to him. He plunged me to victory beneath the cleansing flood. I heard about his healing, of his cleansing power revealing, how he made the lame
Father, we thank you for the day in which you've given to us. Thank you again for the moisture which you've blessed us with. We pray your continued hand be on us and pray you'll bless us with what you see we stand in need. But Father, we are so grateful for what you knew we needed before you ever created mankind, before you ever created the world, before you ever created the universe. And that is, you knew we needed a Savior. When we think about what it cost, our sin, we wonder why you did it, but that's what love's all about. And as John wrote, or as Jesus said in John, for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Father, we pray you'll forgive us when we have failed you. We pray that we can reach others with this great news before it's eternally too late. We pray you'll bless us as we go home tonight. Keep us safe and in your care. Pray for those dealing with the COVID virus, and pray for those that are on the backside of it. Pray for law enforcement. We pray for all lives that they matter. And as we begin to get back into the routine of school, even though it's not a normal to us, we pray you'll be with teachers, staff members, administrators, and students. We just pray you'll forgive us of our sins. It's in and through the name of Jesus we pray. Amen.